The story of Tumbleweeds marks one of the greatest epochs of our American history. It tells of the opening of the Cherokee Strip in the year 1889. 1,200 square miles of Cherokee Indian lands on one front, over 200 miles long, were thrown open by our government to those seeking good earth upon which they might make their homes. For many years, our government had been leasing these Indian lands to cattlemen to graze their herds. And then these cattlemen were told to leave. No greater tearing at the heartstrings of those grizzled old range riders could possibly be imagined. Seating their horses upon the hillsides with uncovered heads, they saw their long trailing herds like giant serpents crawling their way through the dust-filled air for the last time. The bawling steers, ever trying to circle and mill their way to freedom, never stopping, always urged on by the short, sharp cries and the boot-slapping quirks of their cowboy masters. Ever passing, endlessly passing, as far as the eye could see, always onward. Then came the wagon trains of the newcomers, the grangers, the homesteaders, the settlers, some with plenty of this world's goods, some with no goods at all. Thousands upon thousands of them, all seeking camping places along that 200-mile line, and then waiting for days and weeks and months for the starting signal, the firing of the gun that was to send them on their way in that mad search for new homes. Mostly all were honest, but there were those who were not honest. Those who took advantage of their countrymen and under cover of darkness sneaked over the line and staked out choice claims. Our government had troops who stopped this unfair practice. They went far into the strip and brought out those dishonest ones and threw them into bullpens. These men were called Sooners. And so the multitudes came from the north, the east, the south, and the west, horseback, muleback, afoot, in old buckboards, old buggies, some even riding old high-wheeled bicycles, all awaiting that magic sound, that great boom of a cannon. The story of Tumbleweeds is entwined, bound up in this great American epoch. And when that boom of a cannon did come, and when all those humans and vehicles and animals were turned loose in that mad rush of destiny, it was indeed a sight to behold. My friends, I love the art of making motion pictures. It is as the breath of life to me. But through those hazardous feats of horsemanship that I loved so well to do for you, I received many major injuries that, coupled with the added years of life, preclude my again doing those things that I so gloried in doing. The rush of the wind that cuts your face, the pounding hoofs of the pursuing posse, out there in front, a fallen tree trunk that spans a yawning chasm, the noble animal under you that takes it in the same low ground-eating gallop. The harmless shots of the baffled ones that remain behind. And then the clouds of dust through which come the faint voice of the director. Okay, Bill. Okay. Glad you made it. Great stuff, Bill. Great stuff. And say, Bill, give old Fritz a pat on the nose for me, will you? Oh, the thrill of it all. You do give old Fritz a pat on the nose. And when your arm encircles his neck, the cloud of dust is no longer a cloud of dust, but a beautiful golden haze through which appears a long phantom herd of trailing cattle. At their head, a pinto pony. A pinto pony with an empty saddle. And then a low-loved whinny. The whinny of a horse so fine that nothing seems to live between it and silence, saying, say, boss, what you riding back there with a drag fur? Why don't you come on here and ride point with me? Can't you see, boss? Can't you see the saddle is empty? The boys up ahead are calling. They're waiting for you and me to help drive this last great round up into eternity. Adios, amigos. God bless you all, each and every one.
Hard to catch. stays forever in the same old garden patch. Thank you.
Thank you. leaves and waste can be turned into pies and tarts. But the tumbleweed, it jumps the fence and heads for other parts.
Thank you. Thank you.